Gosler, and on behalf of the Men's Initiatives Committee at Greenfield Community College, I want to welcome you and am thrilled to see so many people here today. First, I want to say that we have to excuse Gar if he's a little bit on the weary side. He and I are both on the board of directors of the American Men's Studies Association, and last Thursday we were at the board meeting in Detroit, presented at the conference. Last saw him in Detroit on Sunday. He flew back to Minneapolis so he could be at meetings at his college in Minnesota. And 11 o'clock last night, he's here at the airport. So he's a little bit travel weary, but we're certainly glad to have him here today. Let me just start with a little, who took it? Ah, here it is. A little introduction of Gar. Dr. Gar Kellom received his PhD in history and phenomenology of religion at the University of California, Berkeley, and the Graduate Theological Union. He's been vice president of student development at St. John's University in Collegeville, Maryland.
Minnesota.
Did I say Maryland?
Yeah.
Minnesota. I'm weary too. And director of the Men's Center there for the past 14 years. He is author of a book entitled Designing Effective Programs and Services for College Men. He's currently editing the spring edition of the Journal of Men's Studies. He's writing a new book, How to Initiate Men's Studies and Men's Centers on College Campuses. And as I mentioned, also a member of the Board of Directors of the American Men's Studies Association. Gar has been working with men on college campuses and his men's center now for 10 years. He was the first one to actually develop men's center on a college campus. Work that we're starting to do here, he's actually been doing for 10 years. And he's here today to share with us the work he's been doing along with a discussion of the issues, what is going on with men on college campuses these days. So, with no further ado, Dr. Kellom.
Thank you, Lewis, and thank you to Greenfield for inviting me to come here. Apologize for all the posters that are all over campus, but they've certainly turned out a very good crowd here today, so I hope that this is worth your while to come and listen to what I have to say, and maybe we'll get some discussion going. First, if you don't know what men's studies is, I thought I would give you just a brief, maybe four-stage explanation of men's studies at what we're doing, you know, in our work. Four simple stages of men's studies. Number one, believing in Santa Claus. Number two, not believing in Santa Claus. Number three, third stage, being Santa Claus. And then when you get to my age in life, it's looking like Santa Claus. So that's four stages of men's development. Would you mind if I took my coat off here? It's a little warm, but I made a PowerPoint for you today so that you don't have to listen to all this if you don't want to, or if you have to leave early. It's all there in the PowerPoint, but I thought there's so much to say about this topic that if you have this in writing, that'll help you and you'll kind of understand where we're coming from. The title was The College Male Crisis, What's a Man to Do? Because there's so much concern about this in the country. Now, if we'll go to the slide, a little bit about where St. Ben's and St. John's are coming from. In our mission, we talk about the personal growth of men and women and incorporate new knowledge about the significance of gender into their development as people and into their opportunities for leadership. So we're all about personal growth and leadership. Now, we have a conceptual model I want to run you through just briefly because we're a complicated place. We start with the assumption it's a gendered culture. That's number one. Then number two, we have two schools. One school is a men's school and one school is a women's school. So we are in a coordinate relationship between two colleges, the College of St. Benedict and St. John's University. One is a learning environment for women and one's a learning environment for men. So you put them both together, you have some separate things and you have some joint things. Our curriculum is joint, all our classes are joint. We have one provost, we have one faculty assembly, one admissions office, but we have two separate campuses 5 miles apart linked with a bus system. I'm the vice president of the men's college. I have a colleague who's the vice president of the women's college. I have a men's center at St. John's on the men's campus. She has a women's center at St. Ben's on the women's campus. I think that setup has allowed us to pursue this concept of a men's center more than other places in the country, because as a men's campus, we can pursue our men's agenda. But it's always in relationship to the women's campus. So here's how we, this is how we think it goes. You have a young man and a young woman entering this environment, and they go through these stages, which are just going to be depicted by the button Lewis is going to push here to show you just briefly how they go through it. There's a four-year process of development, for example, of a man. He would spend 4 years in our environment, going in and outside the classroom, both campuses back and forth, studying abroad, and eventually emerge with greater gender awareness and a greater sense of who he is. Simultaneously, women are going through a process in and outside the classroom on the two campuses, riding the bus system, coming up with, hopefully, a greater gender awareness of who they are as human beings, and that's how we perceive what we're doing. So that's just a little bit about St. Ben's and St. John's and our own conceptual model that was put together by a presidential task force. So we have this men's center on this all-male campus 5 miles away, and we're, by the way, the home of the Prairie Home Companion, Garrison Keillor started Prairie Home Companion in the building where my office is, and that's where Minnesota Public Radio started. Notice, I don't know if you've ever noticed this, where the women are strong and the men are good looking and the children are above average, it's always not what you expect. It's not the men are strong, it's the women are strong. Okay, so that's Garrison Keillor, that's where we are. A little bit more about the men's center, just briefly, and then I'll talk about the real topic for the talk. Here's what our students wrote. Students came to me and said they wanted a men's center. So the students said, and I wanted to point out that very first sentence, they seek to create a safe and respectful place, an environment for students, men and women, to share their stories and discern who they are. I think that's what we're doing. We're creating a safe place for men and women to talk about how their roles are changing, and particularly those guys and how their roles are changing. We have all sorts of other opportunities for them, and we look at patriarchy and power and privilege, and try to deconstruct patriarchy and look at gender theory and acknowledge our roots in the feminist movement, and we're working for the liberation of all people. There's a lot of that in there, but primarily I wanted to point out that it's a safe, respectful place for everybody. Now, this is how we got there, and I think this is maybe why you came. How is it that we're spending all this time, and why the media is talking about where the boys aren't, or more women filling college classrooms than ever before, or on liberal arts college campuses, where have the men gone? Tom Mortensen has done some of this data analysis, and we used some of that data when we went to a conference of men's colleges. If we could have the next slide. Even nowadays, you'll find in the cover story of the USA Today in October or Newsweek here in February, these same stories are persisting. Where are the men on college campuses? So it's a very real issue and something that we wanted to talk about. If we could have the next slide there, Lewis. Lately, Tom Mortensen, the guy who does all this data analysis, said this in April on his own website. He says, "I've now been pounding away on the problem of boys in education since 1995, and I have nothing to show for it." So he's concerned that still there's so much work to be done, even though he's been talking about it and there have been all these articles written. However, he does say that there's a new project that he has very high hopes for, and it's called the Messiah Project. And the Messiah Project is apparently a project going to start out of the University of Fairbanks in Alaska, where they're actually looking at boys and boys' success in schools, and they're going to gather the best scientific talent they can, start at the beginning, how are little boys different from little girls, and what does it mean for the educational experience we design for each. Now, that's Tom Mortensen, and his analysis of the situation today is we still haven't figured it out. So it's not a surprise, I think, that you're here, and it's not a surprise that there isn't really an answer about these boys and men in education, although there have been a lot of people working on it. Let me just talk a little bit about the men's colleges. There are four men's colleges in America: Hampton, Sydney, Wabash, St. John's, and Morehouse. Morehouse being the largest. The president of Morehouse College got a grant in 2001 from the Knight Foundation to do anything he wanted to do. And he said the one thing he wanted to do with that grant was figure this question out. What happened to all the men? So he got the men's colleges together for the very first time. The very first time the men's colleges ever talked with each other was 2001. Now, I would imagine of the 70 or so women's colleges in the country, they've been talking with each other for decades. And there have been women's organizations and all sorts of conversations happening. But the first time the men's colleges ever met was 2001. We met to talk about this issue, where are men in colleges? We came up with this, basically, as the situation as we understood it. What's really the issue is not just men in general. It's particularly at-risk men, African-American men, and that's this one article by Cliff Hooker, More Brothers in Prison Than College, which has been pretty well published. Native American men, Latino Chicano men, and low-income white men. That's what we decided when we got together was the real issue that we needed to focus on. And one of the reasons why I think you're pursuing this here at your particular college. Now, we have a little more data, for example, that we can share with you. If you want to know all the data, here's just some of it that was published in that report. And this is Mortensen data from those days. 37% of college students were African American. 30% were Native American. There's more statistics that show you that it's concentrated among low-income students. In fact, in that article that was published in October in the USA Today, that was all Mortensen data, and it reconfirmed this data, that this was actually the situation here in 2005, that it's mostly low-income African-American, Native American, Hispanic, and low-income white males. So that's basically what I just wanted to show you about the data. And we can go into that in more detail if you want to. But here's what came out of that conference that might interest you. There were some theoretical approaches to understanding the situation, for example, with African American men that we wanted to highlight in this study. And actually, this has been published in our book. There's institutional racism and cultural resistance. That's an issue. Gender identity and attitudes toward academics is an issue. The need of cultural congruence and the struggle for male minority teachers in the school systems is an issue. Economic competition from the world of work is an issue. Incarceration is an issue. These are some of the really important theoretical aspects of this issue that have to be addressed. If we could have the next one. This is what we added in this whole situation after the men's colleges. There's not only an issue with success in the classroom, there's also an issue with involvement. Study time, for example, is much more, there's much more study time that women put in than men. Women volunteer at much higher rates than men. In TRIO programs, federally funded government programs, there's not enough men involved in the TRIO programs. Talent Search, Upward Bound, these are national statistics. 40% of Talent Search grant people are men. 36 of the EOC grants and 34% of the McNair grants. So there's just a pattern, more women study abroad than men, more women volunteer than men, more women go to counseling than men. And one example I wanted to show you, if we could have the next one, here's from St. Norbert's. They talk about engagement in student clubs, in missed classes, in watching TV and video games. Actually, men do quite well watching TV and playing video games. That's one thing we are doing well. Anyway, the next. But here's a striking thing for me. I don't know if it is for you, but I'm in student affairs. They don't even keep track of the number of men that come to career centers in America. If you talk to career directors who's coming into your career center, they don't even know. I mean, it's astounding to me that they wouldn't keep that statistic. So this is just one fellow, Neil Murray, who was writing about that, and he's just surprised at how they haven't really gotten those statistics. So if we knew, of course, I think we assume that more women are going to the career center than men. In any case, there's not only things to do with the classroom, there's things to do with the out of the classroom and the involvement of men. So anyway, here's some recommendations that we came up with from the men's colleges getting together. We need to understand male learning styles. We need to apply what we know about pedagogy in and outside the classroom. By the way, and I want to make sure I don't forget to mention this, because to me it's one of the best breakthroughs ever. At the University of West Indies, they have a Center for Gender and Development Studies doing great work throughout the Caribbean. They got so interested in this issue, they require every education major to take men's studies. So they are heading this right on, the pedagogy issue. They're saying to their teachers in teacher preparation, take men's studies so you know how to teach boys when you get into the school system. Of course, they should know how to teach girls too, and they should be teaching boys and girls, but it's the first place I know of that's actually saying to be in education, you have to know some men's studies. We recommended pursuing a men's studies approach. Obviously, forming alliance with women's studies scholars, avoiding any changes that help males at the expense of females. It should be a very collaborative effort among institutions, resulting in better outcomes for men. For example, at St. John's and Greenfield Community College, we are collaborating right today, and we were at this American Men's Studies Association. So, more recommendations. Let's work on retention. Let's produce better outcomes for male students at every level. Let's increase the number of minority males in administration and professional ranks, and pursue modifications in recruitment strategies. So those are all the things that we recommended. One of the things that came out of it then was this book that Lewis just talked about, and we have many chapters in this book, which I'll just highlight briefly for you. We summarized that conference in the book, if you're interested in that. Chip Caprero gives a very succinct copy of what, or a summary of what men's studies is. We have Spelman and the College of St. Benedict writing about their support for men's studies and how important that is. In fact, if you really wanted to look at the dynamic at Morehouse and Spelman, it's very interesting. I don't think they'd mind me saying this at all. At Morehouse, you have the administration, the faculty, everyone concerned about providing more opportunities for African-American men in society. And they're very much into racial uplift and opportunities for men. At Spelman, they're interested in not only racial uplift and opportunities for women, but also women's studies. Spelman says to Morehouse, why don't you guys study men's studies? Why don't you really address not only the issues of equal opportunity, but you ought to address the fact that there's a lot more to learn about men's studies. So that's one of the dynamics that we thought was very interesting among men's and women's colleges. We have a chapter in the book on connecting men to programs and services. That's the involvement question. A big chapter on men's health. If there's ever a reason why you should be in this room today, it's to save men's lives. Men are dying 6 or 7 years younger than women. Is there any other reason we should be here? In Russia, we heard over the weekend, it's 14 years. 14 years men are dying younger than women. So something's going on with the whole men's health thing. I know, I hate to bring this up, but sunscreen is one of those issues, men wearing sunscreen, seat belts, you know, all those things that we do, taking risks, riding motorcycles, you know, there's men's health issues that we could explore. Men are disproportionately involved in discipline, college campuses, there's whole spiritual issues, and we've got a whole bunch of things in this book that we could talk about at great length. Chip Caprero, and actually these are just slides that talk about each one of those chapters, so we could skip right over those, I think, if you want. I talk a little bit about men's spirituality groups, not because of the spirituality as much, but because I think now we're getting to one of the keys for what you do with men on college campuses. We discovered that there was a big interest in spirituality in America among high school students. This is some of the data from Soul Searching, where high school students, boys and girls, were both saying that they were very interested in the importance of faith and praying and religious services and spirituality in general. Then there was a college study that showed that college students have deeply felt spiritual and religious values, and 78% discussed religion and spirituality with their friends, and 70% have attended services. And women, of course, exhibit greater commitment and interest in spirituality than men, but nevertheless, it's higher among both. So we think that it's important in the holistic development of men to at least consider the spirituality development of men. Now, we did that through a process called spirituality groups, which led us to this one discovery. We started these spirituality groups with college men the first year that they got there, and we paired them up with older men. And we've been doing this now for 10 years, so we have 200 guys a year involved in these men's groups, basically. They turn out to be men's groups. And then we had two people, Mark Musey and Merle Longwood, who are men's studies experts. We had them study those groups and what came out of them, and we found some very interesting things. One is that this is unique among college men. There weren't any other places where they were creating this really sacred time and space for men, where there were same-sex groups that allowed men to express their inner lives rather than relying on women, and men were using their own experiences as texts. So what I wanted to say that we learned from this is it was such a powerful experience for these guys to get together in these men's groups and talk openly about who they were. That's what came out of this whole spirituality group experience that I think I wanted to highlight for you today. Now, here's some things about what they learned about how it improved their self-understanding as a man. They opened up on issues about male roles. It was especially helpful to young men to see that there were many different ways to be a man. This is the redefining masculinity question. They were able to break the cultural gender binds that encourage men to believe that hegemonic masculinity is the only authentic form. We have a vocational aspect to these groups that helps them figure out where their passion is, what's their role in the world, what should they really do. In fact, we actually help them redefine masculinity in terms of providing service, if you want, to the world. So these are just some of the impacts of these groups. Therefore, we've headed into a goal of creating many more men involved in service. Now, I think if we could have the next slide there, Lewis. So what's going on with college men? These are some thoughts that you might want to think about that might be relevant for Greenfield. Men are recognizing that they wear this mask. When you give them these chances in these smaller groups, I think it's possible that if men recognize that they are wearing a mask of masculinity, that they really, in many ways, are struggling with performing a socially constructed gender role, as Kilmartin and others would say. Then they become aware of gender role conflict, as Pleck and O'Neill and others would say. Then they discover in these safe places, in these all-male groups, and these even sports teams or floors that they live on, that they could actually live their lives different ways. If you wanted to put it in terms of our college, we would say if traditional masculinity is described by Robert Brannan as being the big wheel, the sturdy oak, no sissy stuff, and give him hell, at a campus like ours, we help these students redefine masculinity in terms of being more involved in community, respecting all people, listening and hospitality. Those are some of the values of our place. If it was St. Norbert's College, they have a similar set of values or a similar mission statement. They would redefine the big wheel, sturdy oak, no sissy stuff, and give them hell as a similar set of values. One question I would have for Greenfield is, if you're helping your students redefine who they are as men here in Massachusetts, Western Massachusetts, what is the alternative to the big wheel, the sturdy oak, no sissy stuff, and give them hell? I would throw out one possibility. One possibility that for men is community service. There are some people who have said that. Another possibility, Michael Kimmel, I think, in his latest book said, what's the answer for men these days? What do they need to do? He said it was quite simple. It's two words. Go home. Speaking about fathers and fathering and doing the housework and taking care of the kids and at least bearing half of their share in, he happens to be in the stage of raising kids. But there are some people out there presenting other models for what masculinity should be. So those are a couple of thoughts on that. I wanted to talk about some of the people at our school. We could probably skip that, who are actually modeling this. But I wanted to point out this place up the road, Prince George's Community College in Lago, Maryland. Does anybody know about this school? OK. I came across this at a conference just a couple weeks ago. They had this poster session. I don't think they could afford to come to the conference. They have a project called Men Moving Forward, which is really an African-American men's project. And look what they were doing. They were creating small groups, getting these men together in small groups, having discussions about all these topics, becoming responsible fathers, college and life survival skills, leaving your legacy, why education matters, AIDS, voting, family. They were getting in small groups. They were talking about this. And then they were doing community service projects. So this was the approach that they were using with African-American men at a community college, which is so similar to our approach, which is getting men into small groups, talking about their personal issues, and then getting them out to do projects, like service projects. So I think that's the way they were increasing retention and academic success and developing leadership skills. So there's something going on in these various colleges that are working on this. Now, these were their goals: create a supportive environment for their students, provide reading and critical thinking skills, increase retention, help men become positive and productive community members. And they did service projects in Atlanta and New York, had retreats, sent their students to leadership conferences, and did some lobbying in Congress. So basically, those are some of the thoughts I had for you today, and I have plenty of other things I can say about what we're doing in our men's center. I don't know how much time we have.
It's
12:30. We have 20 minutes left? Okay. I'll run through a few more things that we're doing, and then we'll open it up for questions so that anybody can have it. A few things that we're doing at the men's center that you might be interested in, because I think they give you more examples of what I'm trying to talk about. We are to the point where we know we're impacting, and this was in 2004 and 5, about 1,200, and we're up to 1,500 people that we impact a year in our programs. The projects that we have, and these all came from students, by the way, and I noticed you got some students here, like Philippe and Dan and others, who are very interested in doing some projects here at Greenfield. Our approach has basically been to listen to the students and to work with them to help them accomplish the visions that they have. These particular projects that are in the Men's Center were student ideas. The Morehouse St. John's Exchange was Michael Hahn, the student senate president, who said one day, "Morehouse College is a men's college. It's in Atlanta. Let's go." We got on the plane. We flew to Atlanta. We set up an exchange. And it was basically the two student governments. The Conference on the College Male, which is now the largest conference on college men in the country, was Richard Carlbaum, who was a student at the time, who said, "Let's have a conference." We said, "Good idea." We had the conference, and now we've had three of them, and Lewis brought two students, and you saw we had 12 students from Morehouse, three from University of West Indies. We've had a men's live series bringing in people that were Charles and Ozzie's idea. Alvin Thomas came from St. Lucia and said, "I want to interview St. Lucia men." He interviewed 20 men. He produced an article that's going to be published in the Journal of Men's Studies. He got a 4.0. He went back to Morehouse. He said he had a great experience. Wilt James is a graduate of St. John's who went out and got his master's degree, and he came back and said he wanted to help St. John's. So he started a mentoring project for a school in St. Paul. It's 95% diverse students. One of the students, by the way, is Kirby Puckett's son, from Minnesota. So now we have a mentoring project of our students working in St. Paul. The University of West Indies was the idea of Wilt, a female student, and a faculty member who all went to the University of West Indies to connect with this very powerful gender studies department and find out what they're doing. And I talked a little bit about the St. John's Experience Project. So these are some slides that talk about the Morehouse experience, where we have students going back and forth, the conference, second conference, first conference, third conference, and we bring men's studies people in from all over the country. We have a great program with Don McPherson, who's a former Philadelphia Eagle quarterback, and we have him talk to all the first-year students. So before orientation even starts, they've got sexual assault, harassment education, men's studies, and introduction to the college, all in one session. And then we give them a survey so we know exactly where they are in terms of their awareness of men's studies. We're pursuing some topics like Native American men's studies, which we had on campus this fall, and then some other leadership institutes. So that was our, that's our men's live series that keeps going and going. International Men's Stories Project, I talked about briefly. We're trying to interview all of our international men's students to find out what their story is. And that's the study that Alvin did. This is the Ames Project. We've got board members involved. We've got the mayor of St. Paul involved. It just seems to snowball. And the latest thing we're doing is a service trip that we've combined with this trip to the University of West Indies, so that our students are working in an AIDS orphanage, which is the first AIDS orphanage in the entire Caribbean. And now they're some of the funding actually for that AIDS orphanage. So what's happening here is we're developing a lot of synergy in some of these programs. So this I wanted to show you briefly before we open it up. This was that study that we did about the St. John's Experience Project. And we're now moving it into a social norms project. I think we'll talk about this in class later this afternoon. There were like all these freshmen that heard Don McPherson at the beginning of the year took this Jim O'Neill masculinity scale, which is these four scales of restricted emotionality, restricted affectionate behavior, success, power, and conflict with work and leisure. So we have all these students at St. John's take this survey so we know where they stand in terms of traditional masculinity. And then we have them not only answer the questions the way they would answer them, we have them answer the questions the way their friends would answer them. So here's some of the things we're finding out. Here's a question we ask the first year students. I evaluate other people's value by their level of achievement and success. 61% of the students that filled out the survey thought that the typical St. John's student would agree with a statement. In reality, only 25% would. That's what we call a misperceived norm. In other words, most of the guys entering St. John's think of themselves as not necessarily buying into traditional masculinity, but they think their friends certainly would. We show them this data and say, what do you make of this data? And it helps start a conversation about traditional masculinity among men. Next question. I have difficulty telling others I care about them. 57% of students thought that the typical student would agree with the statement. In reality, only 27% agreed with the statement. So what we have, I think, is an illustration of college men not necessarily believing in traditional masculinity, but they think their friends believe in it. Why do they act in a traditional way? Because they think that's the norm. So we're trying to use a social norms approach to say to men, you know, you're a whole lot more sensitive than you think everybody else is, you know? And why do you have to live up to this socially constructed concept? Anyway, that's one of the ways that we're trying to get at that. We did this approach, and now we're trying to see if we've actually changed the perceptions of the freshmen. And we've got some preliminary data that's coming in to say that in our post-surveys, we're not only having great dialogue about these issues, but the initial impressions indicate that we've not only changed their perceptions, but we've changed their behavior. In any case, that's just one example of the kind of work that we're doing with students on traditional masculinity. Now, the last thing I wanted to say, we could talk about men's health, there's a lot to do. Last thing I wanted to say, this is where I think we are. There used to be no schools involved in starting men's centers on college campuses and doing this kind of work on social norms and the rest of it. There were isolated cases of men's studies classes being taught here and there. Lewis has been one of the people trying to connect those men's studies teachers throughout the country through the American Men's Studies Association. We are finding right now at this point as we are here in your college today, there are 8 or 9 schools trying to start men's centers just exactly like you are. University of Oregon, we met the guy, David. He's a young guy who did a survey with students. The students came forward, like Philippe, and said, we want a men's center. The administration listened to them. They funded a men's center out of the counseling center. And he has just been hired after a year or two of that men's center to run the men's center at the University of Oregon, University of Portland, trying to start a men's center. St. Norbert College has a young guy, had a group of students saying, can we start a men's center? Oh, I love this story. This is their version of how they started a men's center. They got some power tools. They found a room that was badly in need of rehab. They put in the ceiling tile, they put in the wallboard, they put in the electrical conduits, and they put in the sockets and the plumbing, and they refinished the cabinets, and they made a coffee house, beautiful coffee house. And that was their men's center. They call it the J-Men room. And then they said, well, now we have a men's center, what do we do in it? Our answer to them was, well, you add on. But anyway, it turned out that they were a lot of Eagle Scouts, boys that wanted to do some hands-on work that were enrolled in liberal arts colleges that were looking for a place to work with other men with power tools. What I'm going to try to point out here is that even though there are 8 or 10 other schools trying to start men's centers, they're different. They're all different. And it's based upon where they are in the country, who the people are, who the students are that came forward. Hobart William Smith is the only men's studies minor in America. They don't have a men's center, but they really are seriously wondering and trying to figure out where to go from here with their men's studies minor. Morehouse is in the process of starting a men's center. You're here, Rochester Institute of Technology, University of West Indies, badly interested in starting a men's center. So here's what we plan to do. We would like to have you involved in the writing of a book on how to do this. And we think that this will be a fascinating story for people in the country, or in fact, other countries. How do you start men's centers on college campuses? What are the unique characteristics that go into a process of doing this? What are the students like? What are the faculty administration like? How do you provide programs and services for men? So that's one of the reasons I'm here, is to talk with Luce and talk with others about maybe telling your story as you figure it out, like we're figuring out. So we have a publisher for it, Men's Studies Press. And that's all I have.